So this is a really remarkable opportunity, because not only is Mike McFaul one of the world's outstanding scholars on Russia and the former Soviet Union, but he has this experience as a policy practitioner, both on the National Security Council staff, where he really shaped the reset of the relationship with the Russian Federation, but also then as our ambassador. So I'm going to start, because the book that you've written, the title is From the Cold War to a Hot Peace. So I want to know a little bit about how we got from here to there. Because back in 1991, when the Soviet Union came apart, that felt like a huge opportunity, moment of opportunity. How was it experienced at first by us, but then also by the Russian people?
The 90s, you mean, right?
Let's
start then. Okay, well, first of all, thanks for having me. Great opportunity to talk about my book. And this is a weird book for me in that I've written lots of books before. I've never used the word I before until this book, so it's a bit of an experiment for me. It's mostly about the big analytic story, but every now and then I appear. And I say that because I appear in 1990-91, because that year, that academic year, I was living in Moscow. I was at Moscow State University, and later that year, the Soviet Union collapses. And, you know, it was one of the most euphoric times of my life. Let me just say that first. And I think it's important to remember that there was this moment in our relationship with Russia. We did not win the Cold War, in my view. We won it together with Russians. And if I'm assigning percentages of who did what, they did a whole lot more than George W. H.W. Bush and you know, the other Western powers. It was Russians. Gorbachev, Yeltsin, and, you know, the hundreds of thousands of Russians that were protesting to be part of the West, to be a democratic place. And it was a euphoric moment. Maybe we took it for granted that it was going to be an easy transition to democracy and capitalism. And remember, they went through a triple transition from autocracy to democracy, from communism to capitalism, and from empire to an independent Russian state, all at the same time. And in the book, when I wrestle with lessons learned, things we could have done right, things we could have done better, maybe we'll talk about some other ones in the future after the early 90s. But I think that was a big moment that we should have been more engaged, and we shouldn't have just assumed that Russia was going to become a liberal democracy. Remember, there was a bit of a triumphal moment, right? It was one of my colleagues at Stanford, Frank Fukuyama, wrote a famous essay back then called The End of History, because it seemed like everybody was going to be part of the democratic liberal world. And in retrospect, I think we should have focused a little more on trying to help them get there.
Well, talk about the economic situation, because they had this policy referred to as shock therapy.
Yes.
What did this mean for the GDP? What did this mean for the average Russian?
Horrible. It was horrible. I lived there in 92 again, and then in 94 and 95, so I was frequently living in Moscow at the time in the early 90s. For me, it was fine, but for your average Russian, the 90s was an economic depression, and, you know, by the World Bank's estimate, three times worse than the economic depression in the United States in the 1930s. So think about that.
So you've got the sudden impoverishment
of a large part of the population. At the same time that you're being told that you've now become a democratic state, right? So think about that. The Democrats were the ones in power, and therefore there was this conflation that democracy means poverty. To come back to my original statement about it, we should have done more to alleviate that poverty, to help with that social safety net, to take the edge off of that. Many people back then talked about we needed a Marshall Plan to help Russia do what we did in post-war Germany. And I was one of those. I argued that at the time. By way of explanation, not excuse, it's important to remember a couple of things that were different. One, there was no threat to the east of Russia that we are worried about, right? Had there been this looming threat, maybe had China been more powerful back then, we might have been more mobilized to provide that assistance and to shore up them and to bring them into the West. And number two, people forget, you don't forget, but because you were there, but, you know, back in 1992, the Democratic challenger at the time, you may have forgotten, President Clinton, but then Governor Clinton, his slogan was, "It's the economy, stupid." And he was deliberately running in 92 against this internationalist that was spending too much time focused on international issues, not on domestic. And by the time the Clinton administration comes into power, and I think has then the right analytic framework for dealing with Russia, the reformers were thrown out, and that window of opportunity was already lost.
So it wasn't just an economic shock. There also was a change in when it comes to both safety and security.
Yes.
We had separatist uprisings,
yes.
Islamist uprising. Talk a little bit about that change in their lives as well.
Right. Well, Soviet Union was the largest empire in the world at the time. It collapsed overnight, by the way, in a coup attempt, 3 days of a coup attempt in August 1991 that was out of the blue, that then 4 months later it was formally dissolved. So it happened in a very quick and shocking way. And to their credit, those leaders there, and Boris Yeltsin was the president and the leader of them, compared to other empire collapses, it was relatively peaceful. Mm-hmm. And we should remember how awful it could have been.
Yeah.
Don't forget the dogs that don't bark in history. But that's easy to say for me as an analyst. When you're living through it, it doesn't feel relatively peaceful. It feels dangerous. The state virtually collapsed. So crime rates go way up. Basic things that the state provides are no longer there. And then you have ethnic conflict in various parts of the former Soviet Union. And then it comes to Russia in 1994, when that's the first war in Chechnya. Where, the Russian state goes to war with one of its republics, the equivalent of one of our states, to preserve the Russian Federation. And that was a very traumatic moment for the society as a whole.
Now, there also was the politics were not as smooth moving as one would like them to be. Boris Yeltsin was a pretty erratic character. He had a off-and-on relationship with democracy.
Very diplomatically stated, yes.
He was filled with surprises, and you think about the standoff, the constitutional crisis in
1993,
the early
90s.
Yes. Say something about that, too.
Well, you're right about that. That is to say that the opposition forces to the Soviet Union and to communism, they shared an ideology of opposition, and they labeled it democracy, right? But the substance of what they thought was democracy really varied with a lot of different people. And Yeltsin himself was he's a former Communist Party leader, right? He didn't spend decades studying at Stanford University about democratic institutions. It was in opposition to the old order that brought them together. And once the Soviet Union collapsed, then many people that were allies in 1991 ended up being on the different sides of the barricade in 1993. In fact, then I was working for a non-governmental organization called National Democratic Institute. And our job was to help with democratic transitions. And I want to underscore, we were not there meddling in the internal affairs of Russia. We were invited by the government of Russia. They wanted us there. And in 1992, they kind of treated us like rock stars. It was great. It was great to be an American with some expertise on democracy back then. One of the guys that we worked very closely with, his name was Oleg Rumyantsev. Still is, by the way. He's still in Russia today. And he was described by David Remnick from the Washington Post at the time as the James Madison of Russia, right? Because his job was to write the new democratic constitution for the newly independent state of Russia. And that's why we were interacting with him, right? And talking about parliamentary democracy versus presidential, proportional representation versus first past the post. Spent a lot of time on federalism, right, given our experience with federalism in this country and their need for federalism in Russia. 1992 is pretty exciting. By October 1993, when Yeltsin dissolves the parliament and the parliament says, no, we're not going to acknowledge your decree, and for a period of days there was a standoff, that ended tragically with Yeltsin bombing the parliament on October 3rd and October 4th, Oleg, one of our partners, was inside that White House. So 2 years earlier, he was an ally with Boris Yeltsin. 2 years later, he's trying to defend parliamentary democracy against Yeltsin. And, you know, who was the first to pull the trigger is actually the people in the White House. I think that's important to understand, that they were the ones that tried to storm the mayor's office and then try to take the television station. And so Yeltsin had to respond to that. I think he did. But there's no doubt about it that that tragic experience had some, you know, very negative consequences for how people perceive democracy moving forward. And the new constitution adopted after that collapse was a super presidential constitution that Yeltsin put in place and later handed over to Vladimir Putin. And so that had some very direct consequences about the accumulation of his power a decade later.
Yeah, Putin, who was his prime minister at the time that he
in
stepped
down. In 1999,
In 99. There were some remarkable leaders with a really profound understanding of democracy. I think of Andrei Kosarov, the foreign minister, or even Kokoshin, who was the deputy defense minister. On Kokoshin for a moment, one of the things we did right in the U.S., and
when
you
say we, explain why you mean that, because you were there,
Well, Americans did right. They and you personally did right, was when it came to arms control. First with Nunn-Lugar, which is what I was involved in. And I think most folks here know about Nunn-Lugar, but you can
That's
say a word about
fact.
That.
That's an amazing fact. If everybody knows what Nunn-Lugar is, that tells you what kind of audience we have.
But we do have a wider radio audience, so maybe you should say something about that. But also, you were involved in START II during the Obama administration.
Right.
So here were examples, I think, where we got it right and had a good cooperative relationship with them.
Yeah.
Say something about those two steps and any in between when it came to the relationship of our nuclear weapons.
Well, I do think that's right, that even during times of confrontation with the Soviet Union and Russia, I think it is important to try to hive off things that are in our mutual interest. And most certainly when we came to office, so I worked on the Obama campaign, we won, and then I moved, you know, January 21st, 2009. His second day in the office was my first day there, and one of the top agenda items was to do a review of our Russia policy. By the way, President Obama was very interested both in the U.S.-Russian relationship, but particularly interested in arms control. He wrote his honors thesis at Columbia about these set of topics, and I remember the first time we started talking about this stuff, I was kind of shocked at how much he knew. Like, he knew what the word telemetry meant. Like, not many people know what that word means. Even I'm a little confused by it after 2 years of negotiating. But that was a moment, and you're absolutely right that the old START treaty was expiring in 2009. And we made it a top agenda item to begin those negotiations. Actually, we began the process in the very first meeting between President Obama and then President Medvedev. Remember, he was the president back then. And we got it done in 2010. And it was a great accomplishment. We reduced by 30% the number of nuclear weapons allowed in the United States and Russia. That's a good thing.
That's a very big
deal.
Yeah,
it's better than the opposite, right?
Yeah, so. And that is an agreement that's got a limit. It's got an end. When is it? 2021.
Yes.
Do you think President?
They better get going.
Do you think President Trump is going to be pursuing its replacement?
Well, I hope so, because remember, not only does the new START treaty have specific limits about the number of nuclear warheads, it's 1,550, and the delivery vehicles. But it also has a very comprehensive inspections regime. And if we lose that, then I think that we lose confidence in knowing what the Russians have, and they lose confidence in knowing what we have. And I think that's bad. I think that's unstable. And the second thing I would mention about arms control is, you know, the good news through the Cold War and the post-Cold War era, punctuated by the new START treaty, is we've drastically reduced the number of nuclear weapons in the world. That's great. By the way, you can still blow up the world with 1,550, so we've got a long ways to go, but that number is moving in the right direction. What scares me is that we're now entering what I think is a qualitative arms race,
yeah.
Both on the offensive side and on the defensive side, and oh, by the way, on the cyber side, and I think you have David Sanger coming to talk about that in a couple of weeks, and we do not have in place, arms control regimes for dealing with that. Vladimir Putin just a couple months ago in March announced to the world some new, what we would call delivery vehicles for those nuclear weapons. Well, guess what? A couple of them are not covered in the New START treaty mm-hmm. because they don't fly through the air. One of them, the scariest one, which now that he's made it public, I knew about it for a long time, but now he's let the world know about it. It's a torpedo, a giant torpedo armed with a nuclear weapon that's designed to go through the water, and guess where it ends up, folks? It ends in bays on the coast, including where we live. And that's a scary thing. We need to have that weapon within the arms control regime, and right now we don't.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, the U.S. is looking to modernize its forces as well.
We are too.
Yeah,
we are too. On both the offensive side and on the missile defense side. Don't forget that. Both countries are modernizing on that side, and without the proper framework, I think it could be destabilizing.
Right. And in the world of cyber, where we don't have a framework at all, it takes me back to, I wasn't alive then, I want to note, but the early days of the sort of post-Nagasaki Hiroshima period, during which I think, the Americans took the view, well, we had the advantage, we had almost a monopoly, we're soon to lose a monopoly, and so therefore we don't have an interest in controlling these things.
Right.
I think we fell perhaps into the same trap little bit with cyber.
Without question. I was in the government for that. You can imagine being the Russia guy at the National Security Council. I dealt a lot with cyber issues. And in the early days of the reset, when we were in a more cooperative period with the Medvedev government, we actually tried to put together a joint committee to think about defining some of the rules of the road for how we use these technologies. Because remember, you've heard a little bit about Russian technologies because of what they did in 2016. I guess I can't tell you, I need to be careful here, but there's just a lot more. Let me put it like that. There's a lot more that they can do. They have a lot more capacity. And by the way, so do we. We have a tremendous capacity in this world. It's mostly hidden from everybody. And the consequences of what might happen if we get into some escalation thing, I think are pretty dire. Lots of people would die if we use these in ill-informed ways. And I think the analogy to the early years of nuclear weapons is exactly right. And we tried. John Brennan, if you remember him, he worked at the White House at the time. He led our delegation on that. And we were just starting to make progress when relations turned sour. And to the best of my knowledge, there's not a lot going on right now domain.
I want to start to just raise one more topic that kind of predates your time in the White House, but affected your job very much. And that was the decision taken during the Clinton administration to expand NATO.
Yes.
Right up to the border
right.
of Russia. And unlike our approach in the right after World War II, when we decided to embed a former enemy in a larger security order,
right.
We in fact locked them
out
them of out. One.
Yeah.
What was your view at the time of that, and what do you think now?
Well, my view at the time, and one of the horrible things about being an academic and then going into government is you don't get to push the delete button and all your articles disappear. Or when you're going through confirmation hearings and they got lots of interns that have nothing to do but find all the crazy things you wrote. so you can go find it. At the time, I believed in NATO expansion, and I thought the idea that countries should have the right to choose their alliances is a good one, as long as they meet the criteria and provide security to the alliance. Where I think I differed with a lot of people is I also thought Russia should be allowed to join if they meet those criteria. And that's where everybody was with me when I'm talking about, you know, Hungary, the Czech Republic, and Poland. And then the second round, right, the big bang under the Bush administration, which I also supported, but I wanted to keep the door open.
Yeah.
And that's when a lot of people would get off the train with me then. I will say, however, that it, as I talk about in the book, without question, NATO expansion was one of those issues that increased tensions in U.S.-Russian relations, and it did so both in the Yeltsin era and the Putin era. I think that's important to remember. There are other things that we can talk about, the Iraq War, Serbia, color revolutions, but NATO expansion was one of those. But I don't think you can point to NATO expansion today as a source of our current conflict with Russia, because when I was in the government, NATO expansion was not an issue. Mm-hmm. You know, our critics on the right, by the way, would say because we weren't pushing it hard enough, but it, it wasn't front and center because it was kind of over. After the Russians went into Georgia, the appetite for NATO to engage with Georgian membership went to zero. Ukraine, the leader of Ukraine, President Yushchenko at the time, 2009, was not that interested in joining NATO, by the way. He was interested in the EU. And back then, 75% of Ukrainians also didn't want to join NATO. And then 2010, they elect a new president, Mr. Yanukovych, who was categorically against it. So for my time in the government, and I was in every meeting with Medvedev and Putin and on almost every phone call, but maybe one, NATO expansion never came up. And in fact, you don't have to believe me. Don't do it now on your phones. Do it later. Go and look up Medvedev's speech at the NATO summit in Lisbon. It's an extraordinary speech that has been forgotten because of the current confrontation we're in now. But he basically declared that our conflict between NATO and Russia is over. We've gotten beyond you know, that earlier period. And you'll be shocked to hear this. But the substantive conversation that we were having behind closed doors in Lisbon in December 2010 was about missile defense cooperation. Mm-hmm. And that was just a few years ago.
So you mentioned Yanukovych. Let's turn to Ukraine.
Okay.
That rebellion, in essence, and he fled for Russia.
Yeah.
Talk about Putin's response. I mean, he went to the legislature and got permission to commit forces. Tell us what he did and what the world's response was.
Yeah. Well, let me back up the story
a bit. And his logic also.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
I think we have a tendency to think there's no rational reason to do that or no acceptable reason.
Right.
Share his thinking as well.
So let me back up two steps because mm-hmm. I think the context is really important. The first time President Obama met with Prime Minister Putin, it was July 2009 in Moscow. We went out to his dacha. Dacha is a weird word. It's a giant compound. You know, it's not some like wooden little thing. It's a big compound where he lives. But we went out to Putin's house, right? We spent about three and a half hours with him. It was an extraordinary meeting. And as we were chatting, as Putin was lecturing, is the right way to put it, he went on for about 58 minutes without being interrupted by Obama. Obama's he's a very patient listener, way more patient than I am. He went through a whole bunch of mistakes that the Bush administration had made, mm-hmm. right? By the way, NATO expansion was on that list then. Mm-hmm. He just kind of went through, and he was laying out a theory that he had about American power when he said, you know, you guys, you use your overt and covert force to overthrow regimes you don't like. And by the way, there's a lot of empirical data to support Mr. Putin's hypothesis about American power over the last 70 years, right? So he was going through that and kind of laying out this argument. And they got to the Iraq War. He got to the Iraq War, and he went on about just how stupid it was. Crazy idea. Look at all the chaos that had ensued. And President Obama turned to him and said, you're right. And Putin was like, "What? Do you, hold on, hold on. You're the Americans. I'm the Russians." Yeah, he never heard an American ever say that. Remember, he dealt with the Bush administration the entire time. And Obama said, "You're right. That was a huge mistake. We're not going to be in the business of regime change." Mm-hmm. And I remembered that. You know, we walked out to the cars, and Putin was thinking, "Well, maybe he's a different kind of president." But then there was 2011 and then Ukraine. And I think it's important to remember what happened in 2011 because it sets up the tragedy of Ukraine. So 2011, two major events. One was the Arab Spring, where massive demonstrations were taking place in Tunisia, Cairo, Egypt, excuse me, Libya, Syria. And I was in the White House at the time, and I was working on this set of issues. I actually spent most of 2011 working on the Middle East. We were just responding to popular demonstrations. We were not fomenting, we were not funding, but in Putin's mind, that was the Americans again. Mm-hmm. And especially Libya, because that's when we use force. Mm-hmm. By the way, Medvedev acquiesced to that use of force. I was in the meeting at the time when he said, "You're right, we have to stop this genocide." But Putin was against it. And when he voted, he abstained on the Security Council resolutions that allowed that use of military force. Putin went on the record to criticize Medvedev for that. Right. Right. So that's all 2011, punctuated then with demonstrations in Russia that he again blamed us for. And then we get to Ukraine 2 years later, massive demonstrations again against his ally. We're not
in the near abroad.
In the near abroad. That's his phrase, not mine, but right next to him with his ally. And I just want to underscore, we were not trying to overthrow anybody. We were actually trying to cut a deal between Yanukovych and the opposition. The vice president was assigned that job. Biden, he called him like a dozen times. And on February 21st, 2014, we thought we had a deal. I remember vividly, I was in Sochi at the Olympics. I was with Bill Burns. I don't know if you remember him from your time in the government, but... and it looked like we had a deal that was going to defuse this crisis. And 6 hours later, Yanukovych shows up in Rostov, Russia. I remember thinking, why go there of all places? Why not go to Donetsk or Crimea? But Putin wasn't confused. For Putin, this was yet again the CIA, the deep state, American imperialism overthrowing one of his allies. And that's, in my view, why he decided to strike back the way he did in Crimea. And when that was fairly cheap, then to strike back in eastern Ukraine.
And is a piece of that, though, his concern about chaos? I mean, this a chaotic situation right on their border. Is it just about U.S. action or perceived U.S. action?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. That's a great question. Publicly, of course, he said that. Publicly, he said, we're worried about ethnic Russians being killed. At the time, just to be clear in terms of data, you know, empirically, there were no Russians being killed. There were no mobs of Ukrainians going after Russians in Crimea or eastern Ukraine. It was very peaceful. The only people that got killed, that happened much later after the Russian intervention. But that's not an answer to your question. I don't know what he was perceiving at the time. I think, you know, my own read of it is just he felt double-crossed by the West. And how dare you do regime change right on my border and, you know, blaming us for that fact.
So there'd be reason for him to feel double-crossed by us when it came to Libya.
Yes.
There was a situation
yes.
in which we said the purpose was responsibility to protect
that's right.
The citizens against a humanitarian catastrophe.
Yep.
Quickly, that did become regime change. What position did that put? Because they did not object to the original
right.
going in.
Right. Medvedev did not.
Did not.
Putin did.
And in your book, you say that was a public disagreement. So I'm interested in that as well.
Yeah.
So say something about that disagreement.
Well, but you're absolutely right. So and I try to write about this honestly, which is to say, Security Council Resolution 1970 and 1973, those are the two that authorized force. You're not going to find the word regime change there. You're not going to find the word democracy there. And you know, President Obama... This was a huge battle in our government, right? People were on very different sides on this. Secretary Gates, for instance, was categorically opposed to the use of force. He's the guy that is, you know, gets the order to use force. And he writes about this in his own book, that he almost thought about resigning over this. It was a pretty contentious moment. The president eventually decides that we have to do something because he genuinely believed that we were on the verge of witnessing a genocide in Benghazi. And his orders to our government, codified then in the Security Council resolutions, is we're going to use force to stop Gaddafi's military from going in and slaughtering people in Benghazi, right? Yeah. And that's the argument that we used with President Medvedev. I mean, I was there. I listened to it. That was our argument to him. And that's what he signed up for. Mm-hmm. And so when we saw him later, and I remember the meeting well with Obama, and he, you know, he said, look, you did a bait and switch on me. Yeah. And Obama responded, we didn't do a bait and switch. We didn't kill Gaddafi. We didn't overthrow the regime. But what we did do is by intervening, we changed the balance of power on the ground. And a set of, you know, as my mother in Montana would say, shit happens. And that's, excuse my language, I forgot we're recording. Sorry about that. I was just quoting my mother. you know, and that's, and I remember us watching that, and, you know, we did not want Gaddafi to be killed the way he was, at least maybe other people in the Obama administration did. I did not, because I knew it was going to lead to this standoff, and it did. And I think in many ways, what happened in Libya, that was the end of the reset. That's when Medvedev looked exposed to his, you know, to his hardliners, including Putin, and, you know, we never really got on track again after that.
So I've always wondered what the connection is in part between Libya and Syria as follows.
Yeah.
In Libya, they turned out to be not a good ally. They let it happen.
Right.
Their reputation as an ally had to have been affected worldwide. Syria happens.
Change of policy. Absolutely.
So talk about their...
Well, that two things happen. One is, not but a few months later, Putin announces he's going to run for president again. And so that, you know, we assumed, not me personally, but I think there was a common assumption that Medvedev's just, you know, the figurehead, he's the puppet, and Putin's pulling all the strings. I don't think that's an accurate view of what was happening at the time. And what we're talking about is a great illustration of it. If Putin was pulling the strings, why did Medvedev vote for those resolutions or abstain on those resolutions, right? And by the way, there were other places where we saw real differences in their views. So Putin comes back, and after that, and you know, we made a big mistake, in my view, about this assessment of the Russians. But once Putin's back, we're not doing any more regime change in Syria. He's going to prop up his ally there, no matter what it takes. We had some very heated arguments with Putin about that, where the worst was in Los Cabos, Mexico, of all strange places to be meeting with Putin, but we were there with him. And Obama said, look, here's our assessment. If this continues on, this conflict, it's going to get more violent, and more extremists are going to come into the country. I didn't even know the acronym ISIS at the time when this conversation was happening, right? This is back in 2012. And he said, therefore, Mr. President, we need to work together now so that we don't see that more horrible situation. And Putin had a different theory. His theory was, if you back the strong man, eventually he will prevail. And here's the tragedy of Syria. Obama's prediction was correct. It got more violent, and extremists flooded into Syria, including, you know, that's ISIS and al-Qaeda and al-Nusra and all those groups that were not even a part of the story back in 2012. But the difference was, Putin wasn't just an analyst in this story. He then became an actor and supported Assad, and eventually when Assad was looking like he was in real trouble, intervened. You know, he wasn't just watching anymore. He was an actor in that tragedy. And so the lesson for Putin was don't go along with them again because we don't want a replay of Libya. But there was also the lesson on Obama's side. I know he was disappointed with how things played out in Libya, and that made him much more cautious about the use of force when it came to Syria.
So there was an area of cooperation with the Russians on Syria, and that was on the issue of the chemical weapons.
Yes. Yeah.
So they agreed to help pull those weapons out.
Yep.
Turns out they didn't get them all. I've always wondered, were we schnookered by Putin, or was Putin schnookered by Assad?
Assad, yeah. It's a good question. It's good to remember that, however. I mean, that agreement to do that happened in September 2013 when Obama was visiting St. Petersburg. And remember, people forget, we were still threatening to use force, and we were trying to get a vote in the Congress to enable that, right? And Obama felt very passionate about that. And by that moment, when he arrived in St. Petersburg, we'd had the vote in the Senate. We'd gotten the Senate Foreign Relations Committee had voted a majority, and we were working to get more votes. It was not looking good. I remember that, driving around with the presidents Dennis McDonough, his chief of staff, is calling in to Susan Rice, telling us everybody was really tough before they had to vote. Now all of a sudden people are, staying at home and their vacation houses. They weren't picking up the phone to rally behind us. But right at that moment, when Obama and Putin met, Putin offered him an alternative. He said, rather than bombing, let's do this concrete thing together. And as we assessed it, Obama thought that was a better deal than just hitting. And his argument was, okay, we're going to hit them a few times, and then they're going to repave the runways, and then we'll be back where we're at. Whereas this, at the time, we thought we were making Syrians safer, and by the way, our allies safer, including first and foremost Israel. We didn't know at the time that we didn't get all the weapons out. And to your excellent question, I don't know the answer to this day. I don't see how it's in Putin's interest for Assad to have chemical weapons. I just honestly don't understand that. But I also am a bit perplexed as to how they could have allowed those weapons to linger behind, given the rather extensive intelligence assets they have on the ground there in Syria. Mm-hmm. So I don't know the answer to your question.
I'm always struck by often those situations where you feel the rest of the world is overestimating our capability, that we actually do screw up every once in a while.
Every once in a while, and very so, often, yes.
And so I've never known whether Russia just screwed up that time, didn't succeed.
Yeah.
It's not the only time in the broader region where they've played a role in removing a danger. They did this with Iran's nuclear weapons material.
Good point.
You might want to describe that for folks, because I'm not sure that was as noticed by the American public.
Yeah, well, they were vital to the Iran deal that we signed, which I think was a great deal, by the way. I think is a big mistake for President Trump to pull out of it. By the way, nobody else has pulled out of it yet. And again, it's a that is another instance where the reset had payoffs. I mean, first we had to get sanctions in place on Iran to get them to be serious about negotiations, right? So the most comprehensive sanctions against Iran ever adopted by the UN Security Council was in May 2010. And you don't get that Security Council resolution without the Russians voting on it, right? And I remember diplomacy is this weird thing where you travel around the world in various places where you're having meetings with heads of state. It's on my mind because the G7's coming up. I hope it doesn't become the G6+1. But for this conversation, we were in Prague, I remember. We signed the New START Treaty in Prague, and so it was this fantastic party with the cameras. But behind the scenes, we had this very tough conversation with Medvedev, because in the public forum, he actually said on camera, he said, the New START Treaty, like Obama likes to say, is a win-win for Russia and America. And he said it in English, I remember it, right, just for effect. win-win. And Obama used to use that phrase a lot in talking about what he was trying to accomplish with his foreign policy. But behind closed doors, Medvedev said, hey, this is not a win-win for us. We're going to lose billions of dollars. You're going to lose nothing. You don't trade. You buy pistachios from them. We sell them hard, you know, we sell them artillery. We sell them tanks. We sell a lot of things that make money for us. And then B, they're our partner. You guys are enemies, so it's easy for you to sanction them. But we did get that done, and that was because Obama tried to make a different argument, which is to say, I want you to imagine that in the long run, your economic relationship with the United States is going to be more important than your economic relationship with Iran, and in the long run, your diplomacy, your strategic way of thinking, we're going to be closer than you are with Iran. That was the argument, and Medvedev bought it. Mm-hmm. And we did some things in the margins to help make that happen, but that was essential to eventually getting the deal that we did. And you're right, the Russians, you know, they're the ones that took out the fuel, the enrichment, yeah. The enriched fuel.
Yeah. Some of the question cards relate to the sanctions that are on the sanctions in response to the annexation of Crimea and
what about and the sanctions that are on Americans like me?
Well, we will get to that.
Okay, I'm one of the sanctioned people right now.
Here's the situation where recently Putin visited Europe. Austria has always had a pretty warm relationship with
right.
him and with Russia generally, but. You know, his long-term goal is to lift those sanctions,
yes.
right? Get rid of those sanctions.
He's making progress.
Hillary Rodham Clinton was very involved in those sanctions. Isn't that right? I mean, that's part of...
She was gone by then. That was in 2014.
Okay, 2014.
But she supported those sanctions 100%, yeah, yeah. yes, as a candidate running for president.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I guess she was involved with the Iran sanctions, which maybe
she
is
was.
What I'm
She was,
what
yes.
I'm
You're right about that.
But meanwhile, you've got the new leader in Italy talking about lifting those
yep.
sanctions. You've
yep.
got what? Who else? The leftist government in Greece.
Right. And every now and again, our president talks about it. By the way, yes.
And in fact, during the campaign,
yes,
President Trump, then candidate Trump, spoke about lifting those sanctions. Is Putin likely to succeed in the next couple of years on this, despite?
Yeah.
He's meddled in European elections. You know, he's done a lot of things to alienate Europeans.
Right, annex territory in the heart of Europe. Yeah.
yeah.
Well, I have to say, so first of all, let me be clear. When Putin annexed Crimea, I'd already left the government. Actually, it was exactly, I was flying home to San Francisco the day that he annexed Crimea, just so you know. So he didn't do it on my watch. He waited until I was on the plane to go in. But all joking aside, I was still part of the team. I mean, talking about what the response should be. And I support, in general strokes, what President Obama and his partners in Europe did. And here I think Chancellor Merkel was the real leader of that.
Yeah.
And it was many things, but three things were at the top of the list. One, sanctioning Russians and companies that they determined were supportive of the annexation. Two, strengthening NATO, so that we want to reduce any kind of uncertainty about our commitment should Putin want to go against one of our NATO allies. And then third, shoring up Ukraine with economic and political and military assistance. That basically was the right policy. To fast forward to today, however, I think Putin's making real headway in breaking up support for sanctions. And I would go further, not just not just that, but making inroads in breaking up the transatlantic alliance on a lot of things. And you mentioned some of the places where leadership is now more pro-Russian than
yeah.
they are pro-American. I would add to that list Viktor Orban and Hungary. And then within even other societies, where the government still may be, I think, in the right place, but there are political movements in
yeah.
almost every country now in Europe.
Including Germany.
Including France. Slovenia just recently had an election that moved in an opposite direction. And so partly that populist wave that you know, national populism that Putin supports is happening there. And then, let's just be clear, our president is adding to it because he is exacerbating tensions with almost all of these countries. So yeah. He's not making it any easier. And when you have, in nine of American allies right now, the last time I checked the Pew poll, so maybe it's even gone up, but the question was asked, who do you trust more, Putin or Trump? And in nine countries that are allies of ours, seven European countries and societies, citizens in Japan and South Korea, say that they trust Putin more than Trump. That's a bad sign. That's a bad sign for us in terms of what we're trying to do in the world. So Putin, I think, feels pretty snug right now.
In Europe, you think about the issues being our pulling out of the Paris Climate Accord, pulling out of the Iran nuclear deal, slapping on sanctions, on tariffs, I mean, on
Canadians,
steel,
yes.
And on Canadians as well as Europeans. Is there a sense of moral equivalency, though, that seems an extreme response?
Well, we should distinguish between governments and societies.
Right.
I think societies, there is greater support for Putin in some of those societies. They just see Putin as a lesser of two evils. I think, tragically, that's true. With respect to governments, I think it's more complex. It's just frustration with President Trump. I was just in London yesterday. I just got back. Now that I think about it, I was just in Europe yesterday, and you know, meeting with on these sets of issues, it's just a lament that somehow, not somehow, it's pretty clear why, but that the president just doesn't understand the importance of alliances, the importance of working for win-win outcomes, like I just described. Like trade can be win-win. And there are many ways to try to adjust trade without doing the more drastic thing that he's doing. And I hope it's just temporary. I hope it's not some long-term thing, but I'm nervous about it. I think I don't remember, not in my lifetime for sure, has there been such a tension with countries that are our closest allies.
This questioner asks about something, a different phenomenon, and that's in essence kind of ceding a role to others, not playing the role we could be playing. This questioner is asking about post-war Syria.
Uh-huh.
You know, who's going to be shaping that future? Will we have any role? Will that really be much more Russian influence? Are there other examples of our ceding the leadership role?
Well, let me say two things, because I want to be clear that it's not just Trump in this case. There are times in our history where we move back and forth between, you know, when my friend Steve Sestanovich wrote a whole book on this called Maximalist, times where we're trying to engage and really shape the world, and then we pull back. And if you go back and forth, Trump is not the first person that pulled back. That happened during the Cold War, different periods, the Eisenhower years, the Nixon years. Some would even argue that the Carter years, and then there are these more expansionist times, right? The Kennedy years, the Reagan years, the George W. Bush years after September 11th. Yeah. Before September 11th, he had a different position. And most certainly, I think it's fair to say that President Obama was also trying to pull back on what he thought we were overextended, and first and foremost in the Iraq War. And he told the American people that he was going to do that. And he most certainly believes that many Americans voted him into office, and especially in the primaries, because they wanted him to do that, right? And I've had that argument with him personally. Argument's not the right word. That conversation. and so that tendency had started before Trump, but Trump has really accelerated it, and in ways that I think are just not in our national interest. He just doesn't get what I think is I teach a class on American foreign policy at Stanford. I have for a long time. NATO is not just something that is some kind of, security racket. Having allies in the world is a good thing. that goes well beyond just, you know, how much money are you spending. Same with trade agreements. The liberal world order that, you know, Americans constructed after World War II have benefited us in really, really dramatic ways. And I just don't think the president understands that right now. And I would hope that over time he'll understand how, especially with our allies, we can have win-win outcomes, not just zero-sum. Yeah.
We have several questions. I think you caught everybody's attention in your conversation about cybersecurity. So we have several cards asking, is it likely that we will be able to, the two countries will be able to play a real leadership role in perhaps a broader regime, wouldn't just be between them. And the second set of questions relates to a shared approach to combating terror. And I think it would be helpful to give a sense of the degree to which there is collaboration there, but also, you know, where more might be needed.
Okay. I'll take the terrorism first and cybersecurity second. So on terrorism, yes, it happens. Most certainly when I was in the government, we tried to collaborate in various ways. You know, when terrorists attacked people in Boston during the Boston Marathon, we had a really high level of cooperation. FBI agents came to Moscow and went into the Caucasus, and their counterparts in Russia helped them on that. By the way, a guy named Bob Mueller was at the FBI at the time. He came to Moscow while I was ambassador and was very appreciative of the level of cooperation we had on that case. And there are a lot of other cases that I can't talk about because most of that stuff is classified. So that does happen in a day-to-day basis. And we should do that, and we should continue that, in my view. You should also note, however, that there are limits to it, because we have different definitions of who is a terrorist. In Syria, for instance, we do not share the same definition of who is a terrorist and who is not. And as a result of that, to cooperate on terrorism means giving information that might lead to the arrest or you know, military force against people that we don't consider terrorists. So just remember that that's a pretty complicated story when we're talking with the Russians about that. On cybersecurity, you know, just let me say, I knew about Russian capacities for a long time. You know, as ambassador, I lived in Russia under the expectation that every email I sent, every phone call I made, every movement I made in my own house, think about that for a little bit, was recorded. And you should too if you visit Russia, okay? They have that capacity. And as I hinted, we have a lot of capacity too. What was different about 2016 was three things. One, they use their cyber capacity to steal data. That happens all the time. That's happened literally every day, 24/7. And I deal with it all the time to this day, by the way. I just had a major attack yesterday. Use dual authentication, friends. At a minimum, basic cyber hygiene. Please, please, please take it seriously. What's different, though, is that they publish that data for a political purpose. That was extraordinary and new. And then the second extraordinary thing was the use of disinformation on our platforms in a much more aggressive way than they've done before. And I'll just say parenthetically that because we're in this trap polarized conversation about measuring the extent of the, to what extent did the Russian intervention affect the outcome of our election, and our president, for reasons I can understand, is afraid that if we say too much of that, people are going to say that his election was illegitimate. But the tragic consequence of that is we're not having a debate about national security when it comes to cybersecurity. We're having this very polarized discussion as if there's Democrat security and Republican security. There's no such things, folks. It's American security. And I'm frustrated by the fact that we can't have a separate conversation about security. Basic things we have not done. really, really basic things we have not done. It doesn't mean they're going to do it again in 2018. I'm not sure I would. If I were Putin, I can see a good argument for not doing anything here. But it does mean that that capability exists, and I think we, as a country, need to get more serious about it, both in terms of cybersecurity, but also what are the norms, regulations, and maybe even new legislation that we need with respect to disinformation on our social media platforms. I'm involved in a lot of that these days, but we've got a long ways to go before we have, I think, a better regulatory framework for that. And then, you know, to the last hardest question, will we cooperate on this stuff? I think eventually, because I think eventually both sides will realize that there are certain things that you do not want to have happen. And here I'm really thinking of like infrastructure and, you know, cybersecurity attacks that could be very debilitating to either country. And we both countries have that capability, so right. Why don't we have some rules of the road that we don't let the most drastic, scary things happen?
Well, on the question of whether cyber could be even used to affect nuclear controls is the most horrifying. But, you know, shutting down hospitals, you know, even something pretty basic like yeah. You know, cutting off the energy supply. Do you see us now on this issue of election meddling? Do you see us dealing with a national security issue as though it were a domestic partisan issue, not really a national security issue? Is that what you're?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
and if we do that, that's quite a victory for Putin.
Yes. I just, you know, just basic things, just to remind you, like, you know, I think it's a reasonable idea that every vote that you cast, there's a paper trail for it, right? That's not rocket science, folks. That's the opposite of rocket science. and yet, we don't have that in place today. Yep. There's still a dozen states where that doesn't happen. Why is that? That's crazy. That's kooky. I mentioned dual authentication, and I don't want to embarrass people like to know how many are using it in this room, but I think it's a pretty basic thing that if you're working on a computer system that has our voting, you know, who's registered to vote, and especially if you're dealing with computers and networks that are counting the vote, that you should be required to use dual authentication to get on those computer systems. At Stanford University, I can't get on my email without that. Stanford's taken that decision for, you know, low-life professors like me, you know, that I don't have our voting data on my computer. But yet, I cannot access my own computers without doing that. And yet, that basic thing we don't do for those that are accessing computers to count your votes. Think how absurd that is. That's really absurd. And this question, I understand there's some constitutional questions, right? We are a federal system. We're not a unitary state, but we've managed that problem in the past, you know. And I know it's a nuisance to have your cell phone to use your computer. I know all that, but I also know, you know, I'm from Montana. We're pretty libertarian in Montana, and at one point, we finally came to a decision as a country that people should wear seatbelts. And my libertarian father was like, no way in hell, I'm not putting on that damn seatbelt. I'm going to drive around Montana without it, and I dare you to arrest me. Well, okay, that's my dad, right? But actually, he uses it now that I think about it. But initially, he was like, who can tell me what to do in my own damn car, in my own damn country? Well, guess what? We had a debate about that, and we all decided as a society, we're all better off as a society to make people do that. Why can't we have the same conversation about cybersecurity?
So I'm going to ask you a last question that's much more personal, because your book is a memoir. And I wondered if you'd reflect just a little bit on public service nowadays. Because, you know, I look at your career and I say, gee, you know, here's this criminologist who shapes the reset from the National Security Council as a senior director of the National Security Council, then had what many of us think is a pretty dream job, yeah. Which is ambassador.
There are few. Pretty awesome.
There are few
ambassadors. Take it.
Take it. Yeah. but you know, at a pivotal moment in our history, but it wasn't without downsides. It wasn't without downsides. It's not all gravy. Talk a little bit about the experience, the effect. You moved your whole family to Moscow.
Yeah.
Talk about that side of it.
Well, so there are lots of different levels, right? At the highest level of abstraction, you know, since, you know, I was a kid in Montana, never been abroad. My first trip abroad, I went to Leningrad, right? I didn't go to London or Paris or, I went there because I had a theory that if we could just understand the society better, we could reduce tensions between our countries. That was my theory. And in many ways, for the next three or four decades, I've been trying to test that proposition. And so at that level, the book is a tragedy because where we're at today, why I explain, you know, and who's at fault, kto vinovat, for those that speak Russian, is another matter, but there's no doubt in my mind that this moment we're in now is a tragic moment. I'm not celebrating back to being in conflict. And so that story for me personally, as somebody who's been engaged in it, it ends in tragedy. It's not where I want it to be. So that's at the highest level. At the lower level, I would say a couple things about the personal experience. So was it horrible that the Russian government and their proxies put out disinformation about me that was categorically false on their television stations? The answer to that is yes. I had not even been to my office yet, right? It was Martin Luther King weekend that when we arrived. So it was a Sunday night. I remember it vividly. The first hit piece was put out on me saying Barack Obama had sent me to Russia to foment revolution against Putin, right? And as the guy who's the reset guy, right, as I say in the book, I got on the plane as Mr. Reset, I landed as Mr. Revolution. There was no joy in that. I want to be clear about that. 3 weeks later, when a video started circulating around Russia accusing me of being a pedophile, there was no joy in that. And how do you deal with that, by the way, is a pretty hard question that we struggled with as a government. It initially came up on YouTube, and I actually had friends in high places at Google, so they took it down, and then it reappeared, and then what do? You get on Twitter and you start saying, I'm not a pedophile, and you get in some weird argument. So, you know, having my kids followed to school just as a way to play psycho games with me, that was unpleasant. I want to make sure I don't somehow decorate that in some more glamorous way. And at the same time, right, I didn't say but, at the same time, I would say two things about my time in government. One, generally, and then second, as ambassador. I love being in the government. I love being on the team. Like, you know, as academics, you kind of, it's a solo game, right? You sit in front of your computer and you write books. I love being part of the Obama administration, especially those early years when he was really popular and we were doing a lot of things with the Russians and flying around on Air Force One and driving around in places where people were celebrating us on the streets and feeling like you're part of making history. That was fantastic. And if you ever get the chance, do it. And then the second more, the smaller piece of it, as being the U.S. ambassador, I would just say two things. One, it is a great job. Because your job is to get into the fabric of Russian society in a way. I'd lived there several years of my life before I showed up in 2012, and yet now my job was to go to the Bolshoi and sit in the front seats and watch the Nutcracker, right? That was my job. My job was to meet these incredibly talented entrepreneurial people trying to do startups. So it's not just the government. You're doing all that stuff. And my job, and really the greatest part of the job, was to represent my country, you know, in a country that I care a lot about. And, you know, to host in my house It's a great house, by the way. It's called Spasso House. Mm-hmm. Go look it up on the web. You can take a little virtual tour. Our entire house in Palo Alto can fit in the chandelier room of Spasso House. And some of the greatest memories I have is, you know, hosting Herbie Hancock in my house with 600 of my favorite people in Moscow to show off who we are as Americans. That's a great feeling. I remember, I'll leave you with this last anecdote. When this harassment was amping up, you know, the diplomatic security people were rightfully worried. And don't forget that while I was ambassador in Russia, one of our ambassadors were killed in Libya, yeah. Ambassador Stevens, so it was even a heightened thing. And there were death threats against me as well. And I got in an argument with one of my bodyguards, Russian bodyguard. We were going somewhere, and he said, Mike, you know, he didn't say Mike, he said, Gospodin Posol, Mr. Ambassador. He said, you know, we think we should take down the flag because we think we shouldn't have too much attention driving around today because there must have been some threat or something. And I looked at the car. It's this giant black, you know, Cadillac. And on one side is a giant beige Suburban, and another one is a giant beige Suburban. And I'm looking at my bodyguards and say, you think they don't know who we are? Let's put the flag up, because I actually really enjoyed driving around Moscow with that flag, because, I love my country, and it was a great honor. An honor of a lifetime to be able to represent my country in Russia.
So please join me in thanking Mike McFaul.
Thank you.